Hi, everyone, and welcome to this week's episode of Leap. I have been anxiously anticipating this conversation that I have the deep honor of having today with Dr. Pauline Boss, PhD. She is an emeritus professor at the University of Minnesota. She was a marriage and family therapist for 45 years. She is known worldwide for developing the theory of ambiguous loss and as a pioneer in the interdisciplinary study of family stress management. Dr. Boss is the author of Loss, Trauma, and Resilience, Therapeutic Work with Ambiguous Loss, in addition to The Myth of Closure, Ambiguous Loss in the Time of Pandemic and Change. Currently, she lives in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Welcome, Dr. Boss, to our show today. I truly have been so looking forward to this since you and I were able to have a brief conversation last week.
Thank you, Susan. My pleasure.
So, I mean, now that I know a little bit about you, I feel like I want to just really dive right into this notion of ambiguous loss. So maybe we could start with the definition of what ambiguous loss means.
Well, ambiguous loss is simply an unclear loss. There's no death certificate. There's no certainty that that transformation has taken place. People have no certainty about the situation. There are two kinds of ambiguous loss that remain unclear. The first is physical, the second is psychological. An example of physical ambiguous loss would be people who are physically gone, but you don't know if they're coming back or not, so you keep them psychologically present. Soldiers who are missing in action, people who have been kidnapped, refugees who are separated, families who are separated, and so on. But more common examples would be divorce and adoption and people who break up. And so people are still around and alive, but you're no longer with them. The absence is physical. The second kind of ambiguous loss is psychological, and the examples are when the person is in front of you, perhaps living with you, they're there, but they're not there because their mind or memory is going. And examples would be Alzheimer's disease and traumatic brain injury or serious mental illness or, frankly, addiction, where the person is there, but they're not the way they used to be. And again, more common examples would be those of us who disappear into our smartphones or our devices, even when we're with a child or with a partner over the dinner table. We're there, but not there.
I have so much I want to say about this because I think that, you know, you and I had talked about this, that when my mom had suffered a massive stroke, and of course, as a therapist, I worked in traumatic brain injury and saw lots of strokes and people who had, you know, just a traumatic brain injury from a, you know, a car accident or a motorcycle accident or some other kind of tragedy. And I was talking to you about this idea of how guilty that we can feel as human beings, that we feel guilty for grieving the person that is no longer there, the person that we had there, like with my mom. And that guilt comes from feeling like, but she's still alive. I should feel grateful. And I think that it's possible to feel those two emotions at the same time. So what I would love for us to be able to delve more deeply into is, what does this physical and psychological, what do these losses look like? What does support look like? Because it's very complex. I mean, I love some of the other examples that you gave around addiction or people being lost inside of their phones. I mean, these are so relevant of what is going on in our world today. And how do we begin to help people to deal with these kinds of ambiguous loss?
Well, I think the first thing is it has to be acknowledged. You can't cope with something until it is acknowledged. And ambiguous loss is sort of an invisible loss. The community doesn't recognize it. And the churches don't recognize it. And the synagogues and the mosques, because there's no death certificate. So their rituals are all based upon a clear-cut death. And as I said earlier, the definition of ambiguous loss is an unclear loss. So those supports are not available to the families with ambiguous loss. And they are grieving, but their grief is frozen for that reason. And also, as you say, there's guilt because the person has not died yet. And you don't have certainty that they have died with either kind of ambiguous loss. And so you feel guilty, even though you feel like grieving. So you're stuck. And you're stuck for that reason. And you're stuck because the outside public doesn't even know what you're going through. We need to do what you're doing, Susan, and that is educate the public about this kind of unique loss.
So let's talk about, I mean, because a few things that you have said to me that I think have really stayed with me since we talked last week, that there is no closure and there is no healing, both buzzwords when it comes to grief and loss work. And so you don't have closure for obvious reasons. There is no, let's just stick with the physical loss for right now, where people are actually missing, right? You don't have a body. You have no way of knowing if this person is actually dead or alive. And let's face it, we're human beings. If we've got a missing child that has been kidnapped, we are going to hold out hope until we take our very last breath. So there is no room to even do the grieving. Like, your entire life is around this mission of finding this. Yeah, frozen, exactly. Frozen in time and finding this missing person. How does one learn to live with that kind of, it's such a deep trauma. And how do we even begin to help people cope with that kind of physical ambiguous loss?
Well, first of all, grief therapy does not work. So if you go to ask for help, be sure to tell them you feel it's ambiguous loss. Nobody has died. Grief therapy does not work because part of grief therapy is acknowledging the death and the transformation, and you can't do that. So what really works instead of a medical model is a stress-based model. How can you live with the stress of ongoing ambiguous loss? The ambiguity and uncertainty are the culprits, not your mental health. So those are the stressors. How do you live with that? One way to do that is both and thinking, where you hold two opposing ideas in your mind at the same time. She is gone, and she is both gone and maybe not. He is here and also gone. That kind of thinking is as close to the truth as you can get with ambiguous loss, and it does lower people's stress level. It doesn't fix the problem, but it is closer to the truth than either of those ideas would be alone. So you can't say somebody with Alzheimer's is totally present, and you can't say somebody who's been kidnapped that they are dead. You can't say that because you don't know. It's uncertain. And so both and thinking allows you to hold those two opposing ideas in your mind at the same time. And that takes an extra step of emotional maturity to do that. But people do learn to do that, and they're relieved to have that option.
And I feel like it's a relief to give a name to it. And I think that when we can give, I'm going to get so emotional during this discussion because it hits me so deeply. I mean, first, you know, I talked a little bit about my mom who had the stroke, and then my brother died over in Hong Kong. So my parents were never able to see his body. So it was very difficult for them. I think they knew it, they understood it, but there is something about that evidence, right? And so with my mother, with her cognitive impairment, she never accepted that my brother was actually dead because she was never able to see it. And so what I think that what you're talking about right now, because the other thought that came to mind on a very personal level is one of my best friends who has a very special needs child. And one thing that she talks about with that child is the grief that she feels every time there is a big life event, like a high school graduation, right? Because there are these markers in time with children, right? Because I do think that parents' dreams are tied to their children, of course. You know, they think about the child and they think about all the events like the marriage and the grandkids and et cetera. Those things are never going to happen for her.
Do you know what the ambiguous loss is there? The loss of a dream. The loss of the dream child you would have had, the loss of this big celebration you would have had. We had many of those ambiguous losses, by the way, during the pandemic, the loss of being able to have a big wedding or a funeral or a high school or a college graduation.
A prom, all of it.
Prom, yes, all gone. They are ambiguous losses and should have been recognized. And sometimes I think there's a way to make perhaps a second best reparation, and that is have a party sometime, a big celebration sometime, even if it's a 5-year anniversary for all of these things, because they were missed during the pandemic.
And one thing I think about and talk about in this field is that really, and this is on a spiritual level too, that we all want to be seen. We want to be heard. We want to be seen, and we want to be loved. I mean, all the things that we want as human beings that are so important. And I think that what we also try to do as human beings is try to take people's pain away with platitudes, right? We try to make people feel better. You know, so we hear these platitudes when someone dies, like they're in a better place or they're with the angels now, and these things that are not necessarily helpful. But I think with ambiguous loss, that we don't know what to do, right? So
that's right.
Like with my dad, when my mother had a stroke, and how very sorry people were. And at the same time, she's still alive. And like, how do we hold the space for people with this ambiguous loss when we have absolutely no idea what to do? And I think sometimes we think that doing nothing or staying silent, or because we're at such a loss, what would you recommend? Like when you say we need to at least recognize it, how do we do this in our culture?
I think you need peer groups. The people who are giving care are very lonely, and they lose who they are or who they were, because they become 100% a caregiver. And that's isolating, because you have to stay where the person you're caring for is. It's absolutely essential for a caregiver to get out of the house a day or more a week, if ideally an hour or two a day. And some of that time would be best spent with other caregivers, so they can commiserate with each other. Nobody knows what they're going through like they do with one another. And so peer groups are very, very helpful for this kind of distress. And the research shows that the peer group support groups, any kind of group, a grief group for a death or a caregiving group for dementia or parents and siblings of missing children, most of those are online, on Zoom now, and they are just as effective as in-person groups. But if you can do an in-person group once COVID is under control, that would be extra fun for caregivers. They need the company of other caregivers.
How do they even go about doing that? You know, like I think about my dad who's 82, or you know, my friend who works full time, and then she has to take care of her daughter in the evening. How can we, as mental health therapists, can we help facilitate that? How do people find these online groups? Do you have any recommendations?
They're very easy. They're all quite local usually, but the best, the most developed online group is a group called Duet in Phoenix, Arizona, who is going national. It's all capital letters, D-U-E-T, and it will go national. It started in a church group. It went statewide in Arizona, and it's now going national, and it's based on ambiguous loss, the stress of ambiguous loss, and I would recommend Duet highly, and there may also be others in the United States, and if you can't find a group, start one. It could just be reading the book I wrote, Loving Someone Who Has Dementia, chapter by chapter. You do a chapter a week, and you can meet on Zoom right now or in person as time goes on. It could also be a walking group. It doesn't matter what you do. What matters is human connection is the therapy for sadness and the kind of grief that caregivers naturally have. So they need human connection, not to other nurses and doctors, because that's part of the work, but to other caregivers who understand what they're going through. It's easy to do. By the way, there's a difference between sadness and depression, which I've written about in the book. Sadness is a feeling of being blue, we used to call it, a feeling of loss, but it doesn't interfere with your daily functioning. You still can take care of yourself and you can take care of the other person. You can work with your life. It doesn't interfere with that. But occasionally you have moments of sadness where you might even cry or shed a tear, or shed a tear 20 years from the actual loss when you see something that reminds you of the person you lost. For example, a song or a particular place, a restaurant you've been together. That's sadness. The therapy for sadness is human connection. Now, on the other hand, depression is a sadness so deep you cannot function. And therefore, you do need therapy or medical help for that. But that's the minority of the population. The majority of the population suffer from sadness, and that does not need therapy or medical help. Well, therapy is okay if you want it, but it doesn't mean survival. What you really need is human connection, and that can be found through peer groups.
Thank you for that. And we will definitely be putting Duet in our show notes. Okay, I want to move into something else that you said around the psychological ambiguous loss that I think we definitely are not talking enough about. I don't know why, but when you started talking about the phone, because I think of phones as becoming an addiction with people, where it really is taking away from our human connection. I can walk into a restaurant and there can be a family of five and everybody is on their phones. You see this with young people. You see this with older people, that this idea of looking at our phone, sometimes we're not even really looking at anything, right? It's become an obsession, or I don't even know how to describe it. I do the same thing. You just pick it up out of habit almost. But I think that what struck me when you were talking was, you know, because we see this in infants when there is detachment disorder, right? Where the parent really is vacant and this child is not getting the kind of attention that they need. Now, speed up time into this world where parents are working full time. They've got their phone in their hand constantly. They've got these competing demands on their life. They've got their children. But what you're talking about is really a profound phenomenon when we are so engrossed in our phones that we are not having this human connection, even when humans are with us and they're next to us. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Well, it is an addiction. They were designed for addiction. They were designed for behavior modification, which means that you get a reward for looking or you get a punishment. And we know about both, don't we? The likes are rewards. But the terrible things people say to one another are punishments, and they have led to even suicides in some cases. I think that's a problem. I think all of our devices are a problem, and the phones that hold all that information are something that we need to take control of, because right now that device is in control of us, and it's designed to do that. So we need to not be passive recipients anymore. We need to do something about it. And obviously, small children should not be having these devices for quite some time until their brains are more fully developed. But frankly, brains aren't developed until about age 28 or 30. And so we know that there are great populations of young people were raised on these phones and this kind of addiction. Some are more easily addicted than others, and we have to be aware of all of this. This can be a wonderful device. It can be harmful.
Well, and I think that, you know, as my dad always says, everything in moderation, right? And I think that I want to talk about, though, because, you know, when you talk about the ambiguous loss, I'm thinking about what phones are stealing from us personally, from our own life, right? I mean, we talk about, we hear the buzzwords, be present, be present. I think we are so far from present. I think that we are so driven to distraction by so many things. And so going back to the idea of ambiguous loss and these devices, I know that I think that they are increasing our anxiety. You talked about the likes, our reward of the likes, and the depression that this is causing in people, right? Because, you know, like my friend loves to call Facebook fake book, that when we have these really hard lives and we're looking at these fake lives, right? I mean, we're capturing these glorious moments, whether it's a celebration or whatnot, and we're putting those pictures up on Instagram and Facebook and TikTok and all the things. And I think that nothing is all good or all bad, right? I mean, it is the balance and it's understanding that balance. There are some things on TikTok that bring me great joy. I love to see, you know, the cute children and the beautiful puppies and things like that. But when you talk about these devices are controlling us, give us some really tangible, concrete things that we can actually do to regain control over these devices and really reclaim these parts of our lives that I think are increasing depression and anxiety. And as you said, this ambiguous loss that is happening with our children, with the people around us. Does this make sense what I'm saying?
Well, I think how we can regain control is by awareness. You can't cope with anything until you know what the problem is. So we first have to acknowledge its problem. And you mentioned being present. Yes, we think we're present when we're texting somebody, when we're doing all these other things you mentioned, but it's a very individualistic thing. And I think what these devices will do is ruin the community of our society, the community aspect of our society, because we're not going to the coffee shop and talking to somebody. We're not going to the store. We're ordering online. And may I say this, that we're texting our friends, which is silent. We're going to lose our voices. May I tell you a quick story? I'm 87 and was sequestered for 2 years during the COVID. My husband died during that time, so I was alone. I wasn't speaking to anybody. And I realized that when I did speak to somebody, I had a very raspy voice. I could hardly get my voice to work. Yes, my family is nearby, although we couldn't get together physically, but they all text. Everybody texts, even the college kids far away. And I would text back, and I realized my life was silence. And so I talked to them about, hey, how about a phone call? At least we could use our voices, and I could hear the inflections and so on. But there's a whole generation that doesn't phone anymore. In fact, they say if they get a phone call, it means there was a death in the family. No, we need to phone. We need to use our voices more. Yes, especially I would say, if you have people, older people in your family who don't have many people to talk to, who are living alone, phone them. We can't visit right now, but when we can visit, that would be good too. But a phone call is a wonderful thing. A text is very utilitarian. You get the message right away, but you don't use your vocal cords, and vocal cords need to be used.
And let's just take that a step further. A text is, we don't know anything from a text. We don't know how somebody is feeling. But when you have a conversation, it's expansive. We end up talking about things that we may not even know we needed to talk about. We learn things about each other. It is supportive. And a text is very finite, right? How are you? Good, great, awesome. I checked in with my parent. Let's move on, because
it's more about closure.
Yes.
In other words, it's an absolute medium, as you just said. And we're moving that way at a very scary speed, I think. Where if the individual is going to be alone, they will be connected electronically, but not physically to people. And that is a sort of dangerous trend, I think, for a society, because you need community. You need to touch people and talk and exchange ideas. But that's partly the reason for divisions of thought, because nobody's in the coffee shop or in the bar or wherever people go discussing things. They're on text.
Yes, absolutely. And I think something else that's happened, I mean, I think that we're going to be talking about and seeing the psychological consequences of the pandemic for many, many years to come. But one of the things that I was concerned about at the start of the pandemic and have seen a little bit of this fallout is that isolation can create that sadness and depression. And I think that there were some good things that happened from the pandemic that we know that they cleared up some of the pollution and the waters and things like that, and that we were able to slow down and really take inventory of our life and what's most important. The flip side of that that I've also seen is that people are exhausted, right? And so you're coming out of this pandemic. I mean, I get that we're still in it, but coming out of it in terms of everyone got their vaccinations, taking off their masks, going back into the real world. And again, holding these two thoughts at the same time, going back to ambiguous loss, that here we, it seems like we should be celebrating that now we're unmasked and we're, you know, emerging from this, you know, solitude, and we're all exhausted from reeling from the pandemic. Really, where you need a year just to sort of catch up from that exhaustion. And so you've got these two opposing emotions happening. And what I've noticed is that we're all so tired that it has been very difficult to start hanging out with our friends again. I mean, I have many friends where we've talked where we just don't even have the energy to go out to dinner. Can you talk about this phenomenon that I don't feel like we're really having these conversations about some of these things that have happened since the pandemic?
I think a couple things are happening. Everybody has experienced some kind of loss, ambiguous or clear, a death in the family or a monumental list of ambiguous losses for the last 2 years. So yes, we're exhausted, but we're also now grieving because I think hopefully you're becoming aware that you're carrying a load of loss. Even if it was just the loss of doing your routines or the loss of living life and the rituals of joy and sadness that you used to have. I think we need to recognize that our tiredness is that. I think it's a grieving for what we lost the last couple of years. And it's okay to feel that. I think it's normal, by the way. I don't like that we're saying we're having a mental health crisis. We're having a stress crisis. That's true. Some of it leads to a mental health crisis, but for the majority of people, they coped. They were resilient. You should pat yourself on the back if you're still standing at the end of this. But know that you're worn out and that you're probably carrying a grief. I would recommend everybody to sit down and, as I say in the book, list your losses that you have had. First, your clear losses, like loss of money, loss of business, loss of from a death in the family. Things that can be quantified are clear losses, loss of a home. So, but on the other hand, then list your ambiguous losses, which are loss of trust in the world, loss of trust of even going out now to a restaurant. I'm not sure about the people at the table next to me. Loss of being able to have your usual routines, loss of going to the office. Each person will know what they are. But the two titles are clear loss, ambiguous loss. Each person should know what they are, because then you will know what kind of load, stress load, you are carrying. And so be gentle to yourself. And on top of that, after something so chaotic as a pandemic, major change and upheaval usually follows for a little while. Well, we're seeing that, political and otherwise, climate change. So we have other loads of stress on us beside that. I think what we have to do is find some purpose in all of this. Find some purpose where you do some action to cope with some of this. You'll figure out what it is. You're doing action by having the podcast. But everybody needs to find something that says, I'm helping to make things better, because that makes us feel better. And you don't feel helpless. You want to avoid feeling helpless.
Right, the exact opposite of feeling empowered. Talk to us about some of the things that you have done. I love, you know, you have lost your husband. You are 87 years old. You are still so amazing. I think you're just amazing. Dr. Pauline Boss, by the way, is all over the internet within YouTube videos for those of you who want more of her. Talk to us about some of the things that you've done. You had a book that came out.
Yes, well, I started the book, The Myth of Closure, I would say at least 5 years ago. My husband had rheumatoid arthritis at that time and couldn't walk, but we still had a life together and I had time to think about the book. But then as he got worse and as the pandemic hit, I had to stop writing. I put the book aside. I just put it aside. And I was a caregiver for quite a few years. In retrospect, I was a caregiver for about 10 years. I didn't know it at first. And then it got really serious and then I knew it. And I couldn't write during that time. And it's also when I stopped doing therapy. I needed to focus on him, which I did. I did have extra help, of course, which made it possible. But after he died, then it was the pandemic and I was alone and I was sequestered as everyone was at that time. I pulled out the proposal again, didn't like it the way I had written it years ago, updated it, included the stress of the pandemic, but also about other things that were happening at the same time, like the George Floyd killing, which happened just a few blocks away from where I am, and climate change. And also, of course, the death of my husband, my own personal journey through this. So the book contains both the professional story and the personal story, because I thought that was the most honest way to write the book, to let the reader know where I was. And while I have written academically in my lifetime, I have written 3 books in a more accessible, easy style. So they're quick reads. And not academically heavy, but with academically sound information in them. And it was, for me, a kind of mending of the sadness of loss from my husband to write the book. And I dedicated it to him. He knew I would do that, but he never, of course, lived to see the book finished. It is in honor of him, yes. He was a wonderful person.
I'm sure that he was. What was your husband's name?
Dudley Riggs. And he was in show business. And he started the improvisational theater in Minneapolis. And one could say in the United States, because it was in the early 1950s.
That is so cool. You know, I wrote my dissertation on writing through grief, loss, and trauma, and the power that writing can really have on helping us to really be able to process, right? Because that's what we're doing. We're processing. And I love one of the things that you talked about, that to help people with their stress is to make these 2 lists, their clear losses and their ambiguous losses. That's an action that they can take right away, right?
Yes.
And really trying to get this stuff out of their head and onto the page. What else do you suggest? Is there something else? So now they've got their 2 lists. You talked about, you know, if there isn't a group that you can join, maybe you could start, you know, start a group. What other tangible steps can people do around managing their stress of loss, of ambiguous loss?
Well, I think first they need to know if what they're experiencing is part of normal loss and grief, or if they need to talk with somebody. I haven't mentioned that, but I did mention that the minority will need help. And I have it more detailed in the book, but you need help if you begin to hate yourself for what happened. Self-loathing is not a good symptom to have. And if in fact you're beside being sad and maybe not having the appetite you usually have, and maybe not sleeping as well as you usually did, those are normal, by the way. But the one that isn't normal is self-loathing. I hate myself. I blame myself for this death, etc. I'm very ashamed of what happened. shame and guilt are different. Most of us feel a little bit of guilt after a death, but it's not immobilizing, like I should have, I could have, why didn't I, why wasn't I there, etc. Those are normal, but shame is not, and that has also some self-loathing in it. I hate myself, I'm not a good human being, I don't deserve to live, I should also die. If you have those feelings, you need to see someone professionally who's licensed and who can help you with that. Now, I forgot your question and I may have wandered, did I?
No, you didn't really wander. I mean, I was asking what actions people can take, but I think it's very critical that you're making that distinction because I think often people do not know what is normal. What is normal grief and when do I need help?
I have a whole chapter on that and I go into it by saying that our teachers for grief gave us unclear information from Freud to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. From Freud, you learn from his academic writings that you need to have some disconnection. And in all his personal writings about his daughter and his grandson who died, he says they're still here, and he pats his vest pocket where he must have some memento of his daughter there. Well, that's psychological presence. That's not closure. And Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, I think we've misunderstood her work. And her last two books are, in fact, much more revealing than her earlier books, which gives the five stages of dying, which then people took as the five stages of grief, which was a mistake. But she renounced the five stages, period, when she herself was dying, because it took 9 years. She had a stroke. It immobilized her. She hated it. And she was waiting to die and couldn't. So she was angry most of the time and was probably eager to die and accepted it maybe near the end. But what she has written in, I have quoted her in the book, what she has written is that it's messy. It's not linear. So forget the five stage, forget any grief model that has stages or phases, because they are artifacts of us wanting closure. You get through the stages, and when you hit five, you're done, you can close the door. No, doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. You remember the lost person and have an occasional sad moment for the rest of your life. And Elizabeth Kubler-Ross said that herself. By the way, I adore her. We both had Swiss fathers. I can relate to much of what she was like. We should honor her and remember her for starting the hospice movement globally. That's a major accomplishment. She doesn't want us to remember her for the five stages. Let them go. And so I give guidelines. But the guidelines in the book are to be used in a messy way. Start where you want. You don't have to finish. Pick what you want. Move back and forth. It's messy. That is the description of grief and recovering from great stresses. It's messy.
Everything that you are saying is so packed that I feel like I could unpack so many different things that you have talked about during this podcast today. And I know that we don't have the time, but I want to talk about Elizabeth Kubler-Ross because, of course, I learned about her in grad school.
Of course, this was
back in 1993. And I love what you're saying, because that model of the five stages was around hospice and people who are dying. And as you said, somehow that got morphed into like these five stages of grief. And even though we've talked about they're not linear, they were actually never about the grieving human. They were about the dying person. Yeah. And so I love that you actually brought that up, because I've not talked about that specifically.
I think it was because people yearn for closure. They yearn for the pain to go away. That's understandable. And they mistook the five stages as saying, if I can just get to number five, I won't have this pain anymore. And the research today shows that we live with loss and grief. It doesn't go away, but it gets farther and farther apart. They call it oscillation. And yet it may show up 5 years later, 20 years later at a moment. And that's normal.
Very normal. I mean, you and I, when we were talking, it's like my brother died 8 years ago, and it shocks me that it's 8 years, because I think that the other wild illusion around grief, you know, we talk about, as you know, that we can heal as time marches on, but I think that you described it much more beautifully, that we don't have this acute grief where we feel debilitated and we're curled up in a ball on the floor crying every right. day, right? I mean, we learn to rejoin the living.
We do the both.
It's the both and.
We move forward with a good life, and we remember the person we lost.
That's the beauty of life, right? Yeah. And as one of my guests said, you learn to grow your life around the grief. And what I love to think about is the beauty that blooms in the space that has been left behind, because we do something. Lots of people do things with their grief, right? They transform it. You know,
what they should do. That's the purpose. Mm-hmm. Can I read just a couple lines as we close?
Please read. Yes, okay. I would love that.
If we believe that people experiencing loss should just get over it, then we have shut down our own ability to feel, and we are terribly alone. May we have the courage and flexibility to change. May more people pay attention to facts. And finally, may those of us whose loved ones died during this time never be told again that we need to find closure.
Can you read another excerpt?
I can. This was in the beginning. I just read the end. Now, this is the beginning, and it's a quote from myself from an earlier book. Like enduring a lesson that one is resisting, I learned with each loss that getting over it was not possible. I now walk with the tension of imperfect solutions and balance them with the joys and passions in my daily life. I intentionally hold the opposing ideas of absence and presence, because I have learned that most human relationships are indeed both.
That is so beautiful. Thank you. Can you hold your book up so we can see it? I have to order that book. We'll have all of the links in the show notes for your books as well.
Okay.
Okay, so in closing, I have one more question, but before I end with my last question, I'm apparently obsessed by the idea of the phone. So let's leave our listeners, because we all have our little devices handy. What's one intentional thing that we can practice to start to raise our own awareness of how dependent we've become on these? But what's one thing that we can do around beginning to gain control over our devices and being more present with our friends, with our family, with our children?
I think, first of all, we assess ourselves the same way people who drink too much or eat too much or whatever, use drugs too much, do. And that is, try to go without it for a certain period of time and see if you can do that. In other words, that's the first exercise. Test yourself, see if you can make it for a week without, or a day, or however you want to test it. Then, in fact, you need to see addiction counselors, because this is an addiction. But I think that most of us, most of you, could in fact set it aside, take a vacation from the devices and see how you do. I hope that would be sufficient, and that you would realize that maybe you're really addicted, or maybe it's not so bad, and you'd assess yourself and have your friends help you with that as well.
Great. And I'll leave you all with one other thing that I practice. I don't know if I've ever talked about it on the podcast, but another really beautiful, fun thing that you can do at night at dinner, have everybody put their devices away and then go around the table and talk about one thing, not just what you're grateful for that happened during the day, but why you're grateful for it, right? So we hear this attitude of gratitude and we say, well, I'm grateful for this, this, and this, but we can deepen the idea of gratitude when we name what we're grateful for and why. You know, what was it about that conversation that you had during the day that you're grateful for? Maybe it lifted your mood, but it deepens this idea of what it is that happened during our day that we are thankful for. So I offer that up to our listeners.
I would say, especially if you have children and teenagers, also have a session of what the problems were that day, mm-hmm. because they may not very easily bring up what happened at school that was negative. So I think the focus on gratitude is excellent, but we also have to listen to the focus on suffering. And sometimes our kids are suffering and they don't tell us.
Some people call it the rose and the thorn. They go around the table.
I like that. Yeah. I love that.
Yeah.
Love
that. What's the rose and the thorn, or the high point, low point? We do that on our
team. It's excellent. The rose and the thorn is lovely.
Isn't that sweet?
That's good.
Uh-huh. And my brother told me about the rose and the thorn. Okay. So my last question to end this really thought-provoking conversation is, what does self-love look like for you in this time?
Well, I just think you have a certain serenity and satisfaction with yourself. You're not naive in that you know when you've made a mistake. I had to make two apologies for something I said during the pandemic. Again, because social skills just went out the window being alone for 2.5 years. So I don't call it self-love as much as self-satisfaction. That you're content. I like that word. I feel content at my age. I feel content about what has happened, what I've done, who I am, the people I've loved, the many people who have died in my life. Many of my friends are gone too. And I'm content about my children and grandchildren, very proud. And I'm content about how I'm living right now, and in fact, asking my yoga instructor to up the pressure so I can travel more, and I want to be able to walk 1.5 miles on these tours, you know. And so that gives me a contentment that I'm still growing and I'm still improving some things that need improving, like physical things. And that's the best you can do. You know, there's a satisfaction and a contentment. Yes.
Speaking of gratitude, I have such great gratitude that you ran across my life and I was able to have you as a guest. I've been in this field close to 30 years and I have learned so much from you just in this hour together. And I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart of this very important work that you're doing that I think can be life-changing for people, that you are putting language to what people are feeling. You are normalizing these feelings, and it really is groundbreaking. And I just want to thank you for what you're offering the world. I'm going to get emotional and what you've offered to me in this brief time that I've had a chance to know you.
I hope you like the book. I think people are finding it very helpful after this tough couple of years we've gone through.
I can't wait to read it. And I hope you come back on this show again someday. And thank you so much for being here.
Okay. Good luck to you.
Thank you. Bye, everyone. Thank you for listening.